And it hits me, oh my gosh, this is that triangle.
You know, there's explanation for everything that occurred in the Rendlesham Forest incident that doesn't involve aliens at all.
It was completely silent. It comes right over our heads.
It's so a classic flying saucer, really, standing in a clearing.
He turned over to my father and held his hand, and he looked in his eyes and he said, "We're not alone."
Welcome to Podcast UFO for our live show. We're live every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on podcastufo.com. During the show, feel free to participate live in our chat room. And don't forget to like us on our very active Facebook page.
Hello, and welcome to the show. I'm Martin Willis, your host. Our guest this evening is Paul Dean. He's from Melbourne, Australia. And Paul is a senior researcher with the Victoria UFO Action, which is a group dedicated to investigating UFO sightings. And he has spent decades searching for the truth about reports of UFOs. And he likes to look at these sightings scientifically as possible. He also has a blog, so we'll have plenty to talk about. And we'll be doing a little time traveling because it is Thursday in Australia and Wednesday here. Always fun. So we know Thursday does exist. Before our guest, we have Alejandro Rojas coming up with the latest UFO news. And again, I have to mention this, so pardon me. A lot of people don't listen to every show. So we are live on podcastufo.com right on the sidebar. There's the player, and that's every Wednesday at 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And we are also still on the Dark Matter Digital Network. And that is a pre-recorded show from Wednesday, and that's on Thursdays at 9 to 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So check that out. And that network is not going anywhere, as far as I know. It's going to be carrying on. Heather Wade is doing well in Art Bell's place. And don't forget, if you listen to our show live, it's always 100% free, and the first hour is a podcast that is always free as well. I'll be talking a little bit more about that at the end of hour one. And we have a chat room. Don't forget that. You're welcome to jump in the chat room and pose a question or two for the guests, or many questions for the guests. We have a couple emails that came in, and if we can get the phone straightened out by the time this show goes live, then I'll announce the phone number right now. We're still working on that. And it's time to bring in Alejandro Rojas from openminds.tv. How are you, Alejandro?
I am good. How are you, my friend?
I'm good. I know you're crazy busy, and I really appreciate you taking the time to help us out with the news here.
Oh, my pleasure.
Yeah. So what's going on? Do you want to talk about your preparation for the event coming up, or you want to talk a little bit about news? What's going on?
Yeah, let's talk some news. I guess it'll get into the other.
Yeah, okay.
So to start off, I guess, you know, a couple things that we haven't written about that'd be fun to talk about are the X-Files.
Oh, right.
Which I guess is doing so well that it's going to have another season. So
really?
Have you watched
already?
Them?
No, yeah. I haven't. I saw Bruce McAbee's comments about it on Facebook. But no, I have not. I have not seen it.
So it's doing great, and it's really good. I really liked it. It's heavily into UFO mythology. I mean, really, the first episode kind of outlined all of the mythology and the most, in my opinion, wildest conspiracy theories, and that's kind of where they're going. So that's kind of fun. And then this was kind of neat, too, because it helped us get some local coverage of the conference and some of our research. So there's a local legend of a crash of a UFO, and the local Fox News came and did an interview here and posted a couple of cuts of that interview with me on their website, and they aired it after the X-Files. So that's cool.
Oh, that's great. Hey, is that the one where it shows an aerial view of a crashed flying saucer that I saw, maybe months ago? When they were filming? No, that's something else?
I'm not sure what you're referring to. If you're referring to the X-Files,
yes.
They do have an instance of where they include, you know, these ideas about Roswell.
Okay. Because while they were filming, someone took an aerial shot of a crashed UFO one day and posted
it. I can't believe you haven't watched the show.
I'm sorry.
You are, like, so behind.
I know.
I mean, you are talking about stuff that is just all been discovered now that the show is out.
Wow. Yeah.
So watch the show.
All right. I'll just...
I'm disappointed in you, Mr.
I'll stay quiet on this side.
However, let's talk about this. So also in related to marketing of the X-Files, the CIA released... So this is where... People get it wrong. They always get it wrong. And this is so frustrating, is that whenever the FBI says something about a UFO file or the CIA or whoever, the news always says released new files. Mm. No, people, that is so wrong. All they're usually doing is highlighting files that are already in their records, in their archives. And I think that's what Bruce McAfee gets frustrated about, because he's one of the people, along with John Greenwald, who has helped to get those files released. And so those files have been released. They're nothing new. So, yeah, but the CIA, it's kind of cool they did. They say released a file that talked about how to film a UFO and then some of their other UFO files. So that's been getting a lot of news, and that was kind of cool.
Yeah, you know, I understand why people get frustrated, but also it is, I think it's really good that it stirs up a lot of conversation, even though it's, you know, false conversation. At least people are looking at these files.
Yeah. But the problem, I guess, what the issue is, it's great that it stirs the pot and it gets people talking about this stuff. However, these journalists should be doing their due diligence. Mm-hmm. They should be doing their research so they make sure that they are accurate. And I don't know why they feel they can be inaccurate and completely screw up and be doofuses, be completely inept in their jobs, which is what they're doing.
It's probably because they take the UFO subject so lightly and that it doesn't really matter as much as a story that you can get sued over or something like that. You know, I mean, that's just speculation, but maybe that's
why. No, you're probably right. And that's, I guess, what makes it doubly frustrating if that's the case. But either way, I mean, for any story, I think they should be, you know, having upholding their ethical duties to be accurate in their reporting, which is kind of frustrating. Now, like, there's this story about and I think this ties in about the Planned Parenthood, you know, and these guys who created those videos, how they are getting indicted and they're in trouble for fraud because they say they were just trying to be journalists, but they got in trouble because they spun and they falsely reported things. And really, of course, the media and everybody's all over them for that. And they're getting in trouble, rightfully so. But the media is doing the same thing when they falsely report on anything such as UFOs. And so it's just very frustrating situation.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
but I have another story with when it comes to government files.
Just one more thing. How would anyone call the media on falsely reporting? It can't really go anywhere, you know, when it comes to something like this.
You're right. I mean, all you can do is look for all you can do is call them out and have their peers call them out. And really, that's why it's good that we have Lee Spiegel, who is kind of the only champion for accuracy in this field when it comes to mainstream media. Although there are people like Leslie Kane or Nick Pope who write in mainstream media, but they're not like staff writers like Lee Spiegel is. And so he often calls them out. I know recently he's done that. He does that often with misreported stories. And I know his CIA story is not out yet, but he's working on one. And I have a feeling that a large part of that story will be just that, calling out these other news agencies to say, no, you are misreporting when you say these are new files. They're not. Do your work. Actually read the websites that you're referring to, and you'll see that these are files that have been in their archives that they are highlighting in order to bring some attention to their website. And capitalize on this fervor around the X-Files.
Right. Wow. Well, we'll see. I'd be interested to read that article. myself.
Yeah, I'm gonna try to write one, but I just haven't had the time with all this stuff with the Congress.
Right, and you said there was something else that tied into this?
Well, yeah. So I kind of plugged this last time on your show, I think, about something really cool that John Greenwald was working on.
Everyone's waiting for that. Backball. Yeah.
Ooh, are they? Yeah, here it is, people. Well, people who read our website knew about this. What I posted it Monday night, I posted the story about this. And this is the only story I've had time to write recently. I am writing a press release. That's kind of fun. I can tell you about that if you want later. But this story is John Greenwald once again being told by the government, we've lost UFO files. So what happens is this. He had these DIA UFO files that he got in 1996, early on when he was doing this work of using the Freedom of Information to get UFO files. And this is the Defense Intelligence Agency I'm referring to. However, some of these files are heavily redacted, meaning that lots of parts of these files are blacked out. And so you don't know what information was there. Usually because when they release the files, you know, parts of the files are still classified, so they black them out. Well, you can do something called an MDR, where you request that they review these files, and if that material that's blacked out is no longer classified, then they can give you the files that aren't blacked out or less blacked out, and so you can see what was going on there.
Wow.
This is what happened just a couple of years ago with some documents about spy planes where all the Area 51 stuff was blacked out, but then they unredacted it because of an MDR request, and they let the Area 51 be seen to the public because then it was declassified, and that's how, you know, the big story came about Area 51 finally being admitted by the CIA. So when John asked them to, in this MDR, to review them, they said, we lost the files. They told them essentially, wow, we can't find them, so if all we have are the redacted ones, so we don't have the original, so sorry, there's nothing we can do. Even though he provided them with all of the files, they said, well, send us the exact titles of the files, which of course are in the files he provided to them. But they said, anyway, go through these hoops of sending us those titles, and we'll do another search. But of course, that search, I'm sure, is going to be fruitless. He's going through the effort of doing that just to see what happens, but of course he's got no faith they'll find him. If they couldn't find him with actually having the files themselves, they're not going to be able to find him with just the titles. And this, interestingly, happened to him just last year. He did the same thing with NSA documents, and these were important documents that were part of a lawsuit in the 70s. These are the ones that Stanton Friedman holds up that are all super blacked out. And he did the same thing. He did an MDR and said, hey, you know, clean these up. Give us some more information. And they said, oh, sorry, we lost those originals, so we can't give you any more information.
Do you think that is possible that they're just being lazy or they just don't want to do it?
It's just really difficult to say. Now, if there was a group out there who, and there was a group that had written about this, but if there were some people wanting to spend some money, you can sue them. That's essentially what Leslie Kane did, because NASA told her they lost their files on the Keksberg incident. And so luckily she had some funds or some people willing to kick in some funds. They sued, and NASA said, well, come look. We're serious. We really did lose them. Leslie, you can come to NASA and help us look for them. Yeah. So Leslie went to NASA, and she did look at, and they, and she said, yeah, they did lose them, unfortunately. So in that case, we were able to check up, and they actually did lose them. In this case, it's hard to say. Who knows? Did they really lose them? What the hell are they doing throwing them away, especially the NSA ones that were part of a lawsuit? They obviously were great interest to the public. And UFO files, like CIA has admitted with the X-Files, or the FBI writes this story occasionally, how their most popular files that people look at in their archives are UFO files.
That's right.
So people are interested, yet they're throwing them away?
You know, unless they're refiled, that could be another thing. I would think that they would digitalize whatever they have when it comes to actually withdrawing these things out to send them instead of just refiling them. You would imagine that they would you know, digitalize them. But
you never know. Government budgets, of course, have been decreasing over the years. And so they really don't have manpower. It could be an issue of just without that manpower, it's easier to throw them away because they just can't. They don't have the budgets they need. I have no idea. But it's another startling issue of the X-Files being lost.
Now, what is John's topic going to be at the UFO Congress this year?
He's going to talk about these two cases, the NSA issue, and some more. But he's going to, you know, his big thing is that he makes a very strong argument of how the government said they stopped looking into UFOs in 1969, but they didn't. That there's evidence in the files that he and others have retrieved that show that they have not, they have had a continued interest.
And NORAD and everything.
Yep. And he has some really interesting cases, including one. We were talking about Lee Spiegel earlier, where Lee Spiegel was going to write a story about one of his files that showed this. And this was back in 2011. And when Lee Spiegel asked about the file that said that they still ask for UFOs to be reported by their pilots, that when Lee went to post his story, they had taken that chapter out of this file.
Really?
And this was a chapter they had in there for decades that UFO researchers were well aware of. But just coincidentally, during that week period of time where Lee was writing and gathering his information for his story, first time he looked, it was there. By the time he posted his story a few days later, it was changed.
Unbelievable. You know, it's shocking. The thing that's really funny about this is I would think, of course, they'd want them to report something mysterious in the sky. You know, bottom line, but they just don't want to admit it, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're right. I think that they just don't want to be harassed by people asking about what has been reported to them. And that's what this section of the document was. It was called service. So essentially highly important reports. And you're supposed to report, you know, missiles, foreign aircraft, stuff like this. And unidentified flying objects was one of those. In fact, Canada used to be, you know, with NORAD, Canada's a partner. And I've got this old poster. And in fact, Canada has it on one of their government websites, which has this exact section in a poster. And they highlight, report these things. And in the part that says UFO, it has a disc and like a Buck Rogers kind of ship drawn on this poster as to what to report. So it's really fascinating. So that report or that reporting structure was in place for decades until Lee Spiegel asked about it and wanted to make a big deal out of it. So really weird.
You know, the Huffington Post is a pretty major, you know, media source where they know they're going to get a lot of, you know, there's going to be a lot of people looking.
They're always one of the top five, usually sometimes in the top three when it comes to the most viewed news sites on the internet.
Yeah.
So they're up there with the CNNs and the MSNBCs and all of those. They are up there, one of the top dogs. So, yeah, so that's a big deal. So it is pretty cool.
We're going a little long on the news. We're already at 20 minutes or so. But that's okay. If you have a UFO story as well?
I do, but I want to talk. Can I talk about my press release I'm writing?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Go ahead. Sure.
Because that's more fun. We do have some interesting sightings at openminds.tv, so go check it out. A couple videos. None of them are groundbreaking, but they're interesting stories. However, this press release I'm writing, like right now, is about academics debating alien abduction at the UFO Congress. And what I love about this is I'm writing, this isn't what you think. They're not debating whether or not there are alien abductions. To this group, that's a foregone conclusion. Instead, they're debating whether it's good or bad. And on this panel, we're going to have David Jacobs, who believes aliens are among us. I'm sure you've probably had him on the show.
Yeah, a few times.
Yeah, so they're familiar with his perspective. We're also having another former professor, Joe Lewells, who is on the positive side. He even relates this to the spirituality of the whole experience and everything. And then we're going to have Barbara Lamb, who's a certified marriage and family therapist. And she's, of course, says she's talked to thousands of people. And then Yvonne Smith, who also says she's talked to 1,000 people or thousands. She's going to be moderating this panel. But it ought to be fun because we have these two guys on just the polar opposites. And then we have these two ladies, these certified therapists who also have worked in this more in the middle. So I think it should be fascinating. And I think the media is going to be fascinated by the idea that these academics are going to be discussing this. So this ought to be a lot of fun.
Wow. Yeah, I like any type of open discussion like that. I always think there's much more going on than someone just going up with a PowerPoint and, you know, talking about whatever their topic is. When there's interaction, you know, new things get brought up that wouldn't even be thought about. So, yeah, that'll be great. So thanks so much, Alejandro, and we'll be talking to you next week.
Thank you, buddy. Talk to you soon.
All right, everyone, hang in there for the quick music break. We'll be right back with Paul Dean. Well, welcome to the show, Paul.
Hi. It's very good to be on here. I haven't done a show in America for a long time.
Really? Well, I have mentioned a number of times on this show that although Australia has, may get the number wrong, approximately 26 million people, it's usually in the second or third top listeners to this show.
Really?
Yes. Jeez. And that's got to mean something in a lot of different ways, I think.
Well, we've got a lot of time on our hands. That's what.
never thought of that. And also, we have Shane, and he's a faithful listener in the chat room. He's always on here. He's in a different time zone. He's at 11 a.m. You're at noon time, or just afternoon right now.
That's right.
So I would like for you to tell the listener who may have never heard of you, your background, and what got you interested in UFOs, but basically more of your background from the start of your interest up to now.
Right. Okay. So I'm 37 years old, married with two kids in a huge city called Melbourne. What actually happened was, I've got a very, I suppose, scientific and technical mind. When I was very young, my father was actually in the army, and before I was born, so 1975, my father had something. He was driving alone. He had something unusual follow him at night, middle of the night, and actually shine down a light on the car. And he's never been able to explain it. And he doesn't particularly even like talking about it. But it was certainly something that he wasn't expecting. Now the other thing is, so he told me about this when I was in my early teens. The other thing is that if you're a Melburnian, if you live in Australia, there's one case that you will never, ever, ever get away from, and that's the disappearance of pilot Frederick Valentik. And for anyone that doesn't know, I'll cut it right short, but a 21-year-old pilot in a single-engine Cessna took off from a suburban airport in Melbourne, headed southwest, then due south, or nearly due south. And he jumped on the radio at about sunset, and he had a 12 minute quite a long conversation with the flight services unit, air traffic controller, flight services unit person at our international airport, and he variously described being harassed by four bright lights, four bright green lights, a metallic object. You know, this is all in official government paperwork. I mean, his final words were, his final words were, Melbourne, that aircraft is hovering on top of me again. It's hovering and it's not an aircraft. And then he was never seen again. I mean, there was no plane, there was no wreckage, nothing. So this mystery has been, you know, plaguing Australia and Melbourne for you know, nearly 40 years. And it comes up in the media all the time. And I remember being a young boy and hearing about this. And, of course, you're absolutely tantalised because not only do you have a pilot that's reporting something really strange, probably harassing his aircraft, and then you've got the problem that he was never found. I mean, they found oil slicks, but they turn out to be from a diesel freighter, a seagoing vessel. I mean, that's the closest lead we got. There was just, you know, the accident investigation review was just came up, presumed fatal, unknown cause of accident. But his final words were, you know, in some ways quite chilling. So that's how I got into it. But what I did differently than a lot of people, I tried to be as objective as I could. So, you know, this is back way before the internet. So I was relying on books only. So books from the library, books from all sorts of libraries, maybe newspaper articles. And what I gravitated towards was, I mean, generally as a teenager and into my 20s, I was quite adept to assuming that virtually all of it was absolute rubbish. But what kept me going was the fact that every now and again you'd see a specific, well-known cases where high-ranking military intelligence or agency people from all over the world, could be, you know, from Japan's self-defense forces through to America's, you know, air combat command or strategic air command through to Britain's, you know, undersecretary for air, whatever, people of high caliber making some pretty incredible statements. You know, we've all heard of the really famous statement, like, you know, Nathan Twining, Lieutenant General's, the phenomenon is real, not visionary or fictitious. That's in a famous memo, from 1948. Now that 47. So those sort of statements, whether they were, you know, in radio interviews with those people retired, or in actual official, you know, letters and memos, or, you know, discussion papers, position statements, and so on. That's what got me, because I just thought, how can people who are running 3,000, 5,000 troops, or an entire corps of intelligence personnel, or you know half a cryptography agency, or, you know, like three squadrons of combat jets worth, you know, $500 million, how can these people be saying, you know, making these comments sometimes repeatedly? You know, that you'd have to worry about who's running certain Western militaries and defence outfits if you've got people making these claims. I mean, there are dozens of these famous quotes. You know, there is extraordinary statements right through to the 2000s. And that's what I got interested in. And the other thing that I was interested in was it appeared to me in books that there were just simply cases that, you know, you took everything away. They could not be explained by anything mundane, nothing astronomical, nothing man-made, certainly not, you know, elaborate hoaxes involving, you know, hundreds of people, and not a person breathes a word of it. You know, I just didn't buy it. So I had to assume that there was something going on. So I studied the phenomenon. I read books. I shy right away from, you know, say, the more, I suppose, extreme flamboyant or you know, stuff that wouldn't be testable in court. You know, look, if someone comes to me and says, you know, can you give me some evidence that would stand up in court? I'd probably give them something like a 20 or 30 page analysis of radar track files. But if someone came to me, if I gave them, say a possible repeat abduction case of a 10-year-old, you know, that it wouldn't. I think the judge would throw it out. Now, whether it happened or not, it to me is irrelevant. I solely look for evidence that would stand up to a judge. That's what I enjoy doing, and not enough people do it. So I've taken on that role, certainly here in Australia. So what I specialise in is government documents, government files, basically from all over the world: Australian, United States, Canada, Brazil, Britain, France, Spain, Portugal, Italy, Russia, Belarus, South Korea, New Zealand. So, so I maintain an enormous archive of government files here. I work with some of the old school people, some of the listeners might remember an infamous book in 1984 that came out called Clear Intent, which just blew the lid on post-Project Blue Book study of UFO reporting, investigation to the US Department of Defense. I mean, Barry Greenwood and Lawrence Fawcett wrote the book with the help of Robert Todd. And, I can't pronounce his name. Is it Alejandro Rojas?
Alejandro Rojas. It's not actually the Spanish way. That's, I won't do it, but it's totally different. But that's the American way of pronouncing his name.
Yeah, well, Alejandro Rojas was discussing before the release of the CIA files, and that the CIA might make a bit of a release on their website, and I could not agree with Rojas more. The media are absolutely hopeless. They, they've done this time and time again. The biggest one recently was with John Greenwald's put, almost all the Blue Book case files, case by case PDF'd, and Office of Air Force Special Investigation files, plus administration and policy files for Air Technical Intelligence Center Project Blue Book, and the AFOSI headquarters and field commands. He put them on his website, and the media were saying things like, "Finally, these files were released." Well, in fact, they were redacted. They were released redacted in 1975 in microfilm to the National Archives and Maxwell Air Force Base Historical Agency, and then they were, you could order them by microfilm, so that Hynek studied them. They've been on fault free for years, and National Archives, the media are useless. But so but what I particularly study is, I suppose, post 1969, so when the US government, at least, and a few others got out of the UFO game, when they said, basically, look, there is nothing to this, it's very interesting, but there's no science that we can really do. When they got out of it, they didn't really get out of it. The reporting channels that Alejandro Rojas was talking about before, he was talking about a chapter in the Air Force Instruction 206-12, I think it is, 206-10, sorry. He was saying that there was a chapter in there for UFOs. It's called Service Instructions, Communications, Vital Intelligence Sightings. That existed up until very recently, and there are other channels too, operational reporting, commander situation reporting, various other classified channels that can handle and do handle UFO reports, particularly above US military installations, etc. That's what I study, and not enough people are doing it. The UFO community in this particular area simply has not got its act together. If there is a cover-up, they're absolutely laughing, because nobody is doing what they're supposed to be doing and actually hunting it down like that they were doing in the 70s. So that's where that's how I got into it, and that's where I stand today.
Wow, that is really good stuff. Now, the case you brought up, that is such an interesting case. And it is real. I mean, I've heard the reenactments of that file of the transcription going between the radio tower and the pilot, the young pilot, only 21 years old. Yep. And it is horrifying to hear that whole thing. And that there was never, it's just amazing how that just the plane just vanished.
Yeah, it was. What happened was, he took off. He was going to King Island under the auspices. Look, he was going to King Island, which is 300 kilometres away from where he took off. He was going there at sunset, slightly before sunset, to pick up crayfish, which aren't cheap here. Pick up crayfish, fly back to Melbourne in time for a very late dinner. That's what his fiancée at the time said. That's what his family explained to the authorities. It was the Bureau of Air Safety Investigation, Victorian and Tasmanian region. So that'd be a bit like saying, FAA accidents, Oregon, Washington region, something like that. So he took off, all fueled up. He was, he had some degree of experience. He'd had a pilot's license for quite a while. He'd attempted to join the Royal Australian Air Force cadets. I think he had actually joined, and he was trying to take it to the next level. And anyway, he took off, and the flight was completely uneventful until he got on the radio. And he said those famous words. We've heard it in so many pilot cases. He said, you know, well, first he said, Melbourne, but his next words were, have you got any traffic up with me, or whatever he said. And, of course, Melbourne said, no, you shouldn't have any traffic up there. And he said, look, I've got some traffic with me, and the flight services unit air traffic controller, Steve Roby, said, what sort of traffic is it? Describe it. And he said, look, it looks like four bright landing lights, you know, flying past me. And then he says, it's going at speeds that I just can't identify. And the air traffic controller is saying, look, can you describe it a bit better? You know, the air traffic controller actually took a break for a second and got on to the Royal Australian Air Force and just quickly said to them at Sale Air Force Base, look, are you flying anything near in Bass Strait? And they said no. And they came, air traffic controller Steve Roby came back to the pilot and said, look, is the object or aircraft still with you? And he said, look, it is. It's all metallic-like on the outside. That is pretty weird. He never once said the word UFO. He never once said the word spacecraft or craft. He I don't even think he said object. He said again. This part's garbled. It trails out. But he said it's, well, first he said it was all metallic and shiny on the outside, and then again he said it's metallic, and the air traffic controller was so stumped, he just did not. I mean, he's underground back in Melbourne, and this pilot's just flying at, you know, 5,000 feet, 4,000 feet, just so they're both blind to each other. And the exacerbated air traffic controller said, Roger, what are your intentions? And the pilot said, Melbourne, this is Delta Sierra Juliet. My intentions are to go to King Island, Melbourne. That aircraft is hovering on top of me again. It's hovering, and it's not an aircraft. Now, what's weird is a couple of seconds later, he said, Melbourne, this is Delta Sierra Juliet. Then the sound went bizarre, and it went Dick Haynes, the NACAP ex-NASA UAP researcher, actually he's got a cop. Very few, the actual audio tape of this incident does still exist in a couple of people's hands. Dick Haynes has a copy, and he's released the last 17 seconds of what happened. Was as the pilot said the very last words, a bizarre metallic scraping sort of shaking noise. It's almost like someone's gotten a marble inside a tin can and spinning it round. This bizarre noise just goes for 17 seconds. It's like a pulsing metallic noise. It sounds like metal grinding against metal or something like that. It could be something as simple as a microphone rubbing against his jacket, or it could be something, you know, an actual, the extreme extrapolation would be is two aircraft grinding against each other, or a propeller blade slowing right down against a solid body. But this 17 seconds of metallic noise is just bizarre. And then he was never heard from again. Melbourne said, "All right, I've got to launch a search and rescue." They launched a search and rescue. Nothing was found. They found a few oil slicks that were from merchant naval ships, like fishing vessels. They found no evidence of sort of like life rafts. They found there was no further radio calls. No one saw the plane land at King Island. So it's a mystery. It's probably Australia's greatest aviation mystery.
Yeah, I would say so. Now there are a lot of sightings that I've heard of, and there was a couple of stories that I heard of I wanted to touch on. But before that, I just want to say that if anyone's listening live, you can jump into the chat room. It's very easy, just two clicks, and you can get in there and pose a question. But someone did email a question, and I didn't want to get through the whole show and say, oh my goodness, I forgot the question. So if it's okay, I'd like to ask Charles.
Sure.
Sent me this email, and his question is, quote, as I understand it, the Aboriginal people have stories in their traditions about sky people, loosely speaking. Do you know if any modern Aboriginals are contactees or abductees, whatever they would call themselves, or are they favored more with sightings than non-natives that you're aware of?
Good question. Yeah, that's interesting. Look, the Aboriginal people have been here for 42,000 years thereabouts, 40 to 42,000 years. They have extremely significant – Australia's a very, very old country. You know, the Aboriginals have they have rock drawings, very, very clear, not like some of the stuff you see in Europe, that hasn't been touched with floods and wind. They have rock drawings, which admittedly are, look, they call them all sorts of things, all sorts of spirits, spirits of animals, spirits of ancestors, you know, monsters to scare children when they won't go to sleep, etc. They've littered the country with these rock paintings. They do have – I don't know that much about their lore, about their folklore or their verbal history as far as related to, say, you know, what we would call sky beings or extraterrestrials. That's not my area. I don't actually do that sort of thing. But it does come up from time to time. I have seen, you know, you see the odd newspaper article about it, magazine article about it. I would not be remotely surprised if the Aboriginal community do have a similar folklore regarding peoples or whatever from you know, well, not from Earth. They certainly have spirit realm type people. They call Quinkins. It's a bit strange. But one thing that the Aboriginals do absolutely stand by like a rock is we have something in Australia called Min Min Lights. That's M-I-N space M-I-N lights. And they're, you know, both Aboriginals have claimed to have been seeing them for, you know, for eons. The newcomers, like the British and the Welsh and the Scottish, when they came here, actually saw them as well. And you can see this in, you know, old ship logs and old sort of, like, you know, when mines were started, like old mining expedition logs and diaries. These strange lights tend to hover near the ground. They hover around, there's often just points of silver light, no bigger than, say, what you in America might call like a 10-cent or a nickel or a dime, maybe a little bit bigger, up to the size of a golf ball. Quite bright, and they often gather in, you know, little groups of two and three and maybe as many as 10. They zoom around the place. They often might follow a fence line or follow, say, you know, grass or whatever, you know, like a line of grass or a river or something. But the claims – I've certainly never seen them, but the claims are that if you chase these things or scream at them or whatever, that they actually do respond. It would – some, you know, a lot of quite reputable people, you know, archaeologists and, you know, geophysical people, seismologists have said, look, these don't just appear to be earth lights or, say, static electricity or ball lightning or buoyant plasma phenomena or, you know, atmospheric plasma or, say, even something as simple as truck headlights on the horizon. They seem to be something a bit odder. And whether it's something, some sort of magnetic anomalies that's forcing electrical conductivity into very confined spaces, or whether it's something, you know, paranormal, I don't know. But the Aboriginals have been have been accepting this forever, and certainly in the 60s and 70s, Australia, you know, the wider Australian community started writing about it, reading about it, and so yeah, that's probably my answer to that question.
Now, someone asked on the message board if they have a written language, but they kind of use symbols, don't they? Or am I getting that wrong?
No, they do. The Aboriginal culture has been, you know, we've absorbed, you know, but it hasn't been a pretty history. It's probably a bit like the combination. It's probably a bit like the when, you know, the Europeans butted up against the North American Aboriginals, Indians, whatever you call them, in, you know, the 1700s. The Aboriginals did everything verbally. They used numbers. They did everything verbally, and most of their written history, as far as I know, is all pictorial. It's all pictures in bright, bold colours. Nowadays, most Aboriginal people have just in the, you know, mainstream community schools and so on, so they're just English. But historically, it's always been. I don't think they actually had written language. They certainly didn't have paper. Like when we came here in the 1800s. So,
They were, yeah, you're right. I've seen that. There was the Christian movement throughout the world. A lot of the things from British, and we were doing things. And yeah, I mean, going into these cultures and just trying to turn them into toward our beliefs or whatever they are. There was another question I was thinking about along these lines, but I had Shane Ryan on a few years ago now. Real nice gentleman. And somewhere I was reading online and back in 2014 that the Westall had been solved. Do you know anything about that, or have you looked into that?
Yeah, the guy, I actually live right near it. The researcher who put the solved theory forward, it's a hypothesis. Okay. Mm-hmm. With Westall, just for those who don't know, there used to be a neighbourhood. It's now called Clayton or Clayton South. Here in Melbourne, there's a neighbourhood. We call it a suburb called. It used to be called Westall in the 60s. Westall. And there's two schools, a high school and a primary school, quite near each other. And about 10:15 in the morning, pretty clear weather, windy. This is probably one of the big sticking points. We just don't know. But there were so many witnesses, either one, two, or three bodies, objects, UFOs, whatever, came across the school and appeared to land and then possibly move around a bit, but then definitely take off, right? There was also planes in the area, like small planes. Not major airliners, but small planes in the area. And this all happened. What's important about this case is that there were so many witnesses. Now, most of them were, 10, 13, 8, 15, whatever years old. We're not talking about just a whole bunch. We're not talking about a bunch of adults. We are talking about school children. However, there were teachers that did see it. Particularly, there was a science teacher that did witness it. Now, what's interesting about the case as well is that authorities, we don't know who, but in Australia, back in Australia, it was the Royal Australian Air Force's Directorate of Air Force Intelligence who handled the UFO matter. Aside from then, if it was an air safety issue, it would be handled by the Bureau of Air Safety or Directorate of Civil Aviation, Department of Civil Aviation. Now, whatever was the situation in 1966 at Westall, very rapidly authorities were on the scene. Now, some people claim it happened that afternoon, like authorities were on the scene that afternoon in flatbed trucks, in suits and ties. Some witnesses claim they were definitely there the next day. Researchers and journalists at the time say they were there the next day. Some people say it was twice the next day. Some people say it was the day after that. But we do know that authorities arrived fairly quickly. Now, the case has never been solved as such. We're still in the dark entirely. But what happened was, a couple of years ago, the researcher I work with most, Keith Basterfield, he started looking into the possibility that it sounds mundane and it sounds so cliched, but what about the possibility it was a very, very unusual scientific experiment? Run by, a Department of, Defence, Materials Acquisition, or Department of the Army Aviation, whatever. There were so many odd things about the case. No cases at all in Australia's UFO history has the Royal Australian Air Force or, say, the Army or, like high-ranking police ever been on the scene to hush people up. It just doesn't happen. Very provocative cases. Like even that I was saying before, the Frederick Valenti case, we had a pilot die. The Royal Australian Air Force didn't even care. They didn't even get involved. Wow. They weren't even asked to. Yet at Westall, you've got a bunch of, say 150, 200 school kids who see a UFO or UFOs, and all of a sudden there's multiple streams of authorities on the scene. This is really unusual for Australia's UFO history. It almost implies that they knew what it was and they knew it was going to land there. The authorities arrived at the school. They told the principal to, keep the kids, get the hysteria down a bit. They interviewed the one teacher that got the best look at it, they interviewed the Royal Australian Air Force interviewed him at his home 2 or 3 days later, not yet 4 days later, and they said under no circumstances like this has got to end. You know, like this, we've interviewed you now. Please don't discuss it anymore. Now, this is unique, and this is virtually unique. We have no other cases that we actually have on file where we really where the authorities have been so. You know, interested or so sort of almost paranoid about it, even when there's been even UFO cases right near sensitive military bases or even UFO cases where, you know, packed airliners have been involved going, you know, across the country, the Royal Australian Air Force were never that interested, but this case they were. So researcher Keith Basterfield decided to check out the possibility that, in fact, wasn't a, what we would call a UFO, you know, like something really unusual. He decided that he might look into the possibility that it was a government program that had gone horribly wrong. And what he found interestingly was at the time, I mean, it wasn't classified, but at the time, the Australia's old Department of Supply, which was kind of a defence science department, they were launching, with the help of the United States' Atomic Energy Commission, they were launching enormous balloons from our state, Mildura, in a town called Mildura. They were launching huge balloons, and underneath the balloons was huge, long, like metal, like cables that went down to a parachute. And underneath the parachute was a scientific payload, like scientific equipment. Now, this was all under the guise of, like, you know, atmospheric, you know, wind direction testing and temperature testing and so on. What the program, it was called the High Altitude Balloon Program. It was called the Highball Program. And it was, like I said, a joint Australian government defence American program that was helped from NASA and the US Navy. We've got the paperwork for that. The balloons were launched, and where they would go was just dependent on, you know, high, medium and high altitude winds. What would happen is planes would actually chase the balloon and the parachute and payload. What would happen is the balloon, the real scientific experiment was that the equipment was actually trying to detect fission materials like, you know, I suppose strontium-40 and, you know, plutonium from possibly from Soviet nuclear blasts or Chinese nuclear blasts that might be going on, particularly in the Southern Hemisphere. So that was totally classified. That was not known to the public. The program, people who saw the balloons simply saw these enormous balloons with stuff hanging out the bottom. And you know, but really it was quite a sensitive program to look for evidence that the Soviets or the Chinese were doing blasting down here. So anyway, what Keith actually found was that he found paperwork for he found at the National Archives and through people who used to be with the Department of Supply, he found paperwork that showed that that particular week there was a balloon launched scheduled for that week for Westall, like the week that the UFO event happened at Westall schools. Keith found that a high altitude balloon experiment actually was scheduled for that week, but it actually disappeared from the paperwork. Like, you've got, like, you know, flights, it's called, you know, balloon flights 291 and 293 or whatever it is, but 292 is totally missing. All Keith did was hypothesize, is it possible that, you know, the balloon and parachute and payload are screaming across our state of Victoria, planes are chasing it, things get out of hand, the balloon cuts away the parachute and payload, parachute and payload drift over Melbourne suburb, you know, heading downwards, and go across the school, land, maybe bounce around, I'm not sure, and kids go hyper about it. It's just a hypothesis. You know, the fact of the matter is we can look at the original paperwork from the time and it says that, there's no evidence to say that the actual balloon launch did take place. I'll admit that. But it is funny that that's the only classified balloon launch that's actually missing from the records. And interestingly, the winds that day do go direct from Mildura straight towards Melbourne. So it's a running hypothesis. You know, we don't know. No one's really put it's an interesting case. No one's put a proper file together on it. You know, people have material, you know, newspaper articles and witness interviews and maps and so on. No one's put together a proper case file on it, and it's something that does need to be done sooner or later. So, yeah, to answer your question. That's what that was all about.
Now, there's a couple of questions I have about that for you, and one of them, I may be getting the case wrong, but wasn't there a teacher that took some pictures and had her camera taken away? Is that this case?
Yeah, that's correct. Okay, the picture part we don't know about. What you see, one thing that just never ceases to amaze me, the garbage that's on the internet, just it seeps like a poison dye into everything. If you actually ask that teacher or ask the original researchers at the time or go back to the original, you know, rough notes that researchers are making or whatever it may be, if you ask anyone and say, look, was there a camera with photos? Were photographs taken? Was the camera snatched? Okay, the fact of the matter is we just don't know. There was definitely a camera that was – we're pretty sure that there was a camera taken by authorities. Whether it had actual photos in it, we don't know. Whether it had film that was going to be developed in it, I don't know. Where it went, I don't know. Whose it was, I'm not even sure which teacher it was. I haven't looked that much into the case, but I do know that particular area of the case is very, very murky. There's an enormous amount of murky things about it. I mean, what probably the biggest, like I said, was I've heard anywhere between – some people insist there was one UFO. A lot of people insist there were two. Some people say three. I've never heard four, but now I'm increasingly hearing people say there were five there. Then there were planes. So it's a very frustrating case. We've wasted so much time on it. I mean, it's 50 years old. You know, not enough new has come out about it. Certainly no government files have come out about it. What really needs to happen is that you know, resources get put together and either put the thing to rest or solve it. But it seems to be very, very difficult to do.
Right. It's almost like our Roswell in a type of way. And then the next question I have for you, the balloon theory, does that fit what the witnesses were describing? I mean, how did it go away? I mean, I remember, the thing actually lifted up and took off.
Yeah, flew off. Okay, this is the part we don't know. Okay, the balloon theory is actually wrong in that Keith Basterfield's hypothesis was never Keith's a UFO researcher. He's just as adept to saying it was a real UFO case than not. But what he's actually saying is that balloon wouldn't have been anywhere near it. The balloon would have been, like, if it was this, what happens is the balloon with the parachute and the payload under it fly across Victoria, and at some point through remote control or cutting or whatever, the parachute and payload get cut away from the balloon. The balloon, by the time, by the time it got to Westall School and came overhead, the balloon could have been, you know, 20 or 100 miles away, whatever, or, you know, long gone or quite high up. He's not saying that the balloon's too big. You know, it's a huge, huge, very, you know, vertically high body. That I think what he's saying is it possible that the parachute and payload flew into Westall and then bounced back out again. That's what he's saying. See, the problem is we have so little material from the time. We don't have what the kids were seeing at the time. Most of the people that have been interviewed about this case have been interviewed after sort of 2006 or 2004 or whatever. So they're going on 40-year-old memories. We just don't have any original material. I keep screaming out to people, show me some original reports, even drawings. You know, kids love to draw. You know, there's nothing. There's no diary entries, no school diary entries, exercise books. There's no original, you know, report forms that we can get hold of. There is no original material. And to me there's very little original material. One thing we do have is James E. McDonald, the great University of Arizona professor. He actually came to Australia and after it happened, and he interviewed the science teacher who witnessed the event saw a lot of the event once it had started. James McDonald interviewed teacher Greenwood, Andrew Greenwood, and So Greenwood gave him quite a good interview, like solid answers, you know, only a year after it happened. And that I haven't heard the interview because it's at the Arizona University. A few people have copies of it here. I haven't heard it. But that if you're going to go on one report, I would go back to his because, you know, he's an adult, and two, he was interviewed by McDonald only, you know, a year after the event happened. So his material will probably be the most accurate. So like I said, you know, the problem is we just don't have enough original material. I, you know, there are so many better cases where we've got report forms, pro formas, unit investigations, weather maps, weather data, you know, notice to airmen restriction, you know, controlled airspace map layouts, you know, placement of radar facilities. There's so many better cases where there's excellent data to go on, you know, reams of it, scope photographs, track actual media player track files, you know, rough hand drawings from the site, you know, base alert, you know, military base alerts, you know, teletype messages, auto DIN messages, op rep threes, you know, even fuel requirements for planes to take off and actually intercept a bogey that's appearing on a ground control radar screen. You know, even ammunition logs, how many bullets were fired at it. You know, we've got so many cases where we've got that sort of material. But in this case, in the Westall case, we just don't. So it's turned, you know, it seems to be more folklore than anything.
Right, right. This is where we take our quick break, but I'm not going to do any music on this one right here. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. So it is funny how there is so much out there about this particular case. And I think I thought it was a pretty good documentary, but I don't know how you felt about it. Starts out with a guy looking at the crib and the baby, his baby in the crib, and starts thinking about the whole story. Do you remember that particular documentary on this?
No, I haven't seen it. I've got it. I've never to this day gotten around to seeing it. I've always just read the paperwork on it, like the books.
Yeah.
No, it's something I've got to do.
Yeah. Okay. So I want to get in this second hour. I want to get back into documents and also how you've dealt face to face, you know, trying to get more information. But a question up on the message board is, how does Paul deal with rubbish and fake reports in Australia and work out which ones hold water?
Sure. Do you want me to answer that now?
Yes, go ahead. Sure.
I'll give you an example. Say I get a report, or say the organization I work with sometimes, UFO, let's say we get a report. Let's say we get a report from a couple of people who make XYZ claims. You know, it was this time, this date, this exact location, looking in this particular, like, compass direction, color of object, any sound associated with object or objects, were there any planes nearby, all the classic things you do that you start out with in any UFO investigation. We get that data. One of the things I like to do first is, let's say the witnesses say to me, look, it was so overcast. You know, it was totally overcast, low cloud. I can jump immediately within days onto Australia's Bureau of Meteorology 3-day, you know, detailed report website where I can go down. I can actually work out through this, all this tabulated data and these archived images. I can see, they might say to me, look, we were in Pakenham North, Victoria, looking north, and it was incredibly overcast. I can actually see what the cloud cover was like for Pakenham North. That they might say, look, the event happened at 8:30 in between two TV shows. And I'll say, right, okay, so we're looking north at, you know, at a place called Pakenham, and it's at 8:30 at night. If I go and find, and this has happened, if I go and find that the Bureau of Meteorology satellite records and celiometer records and, you know, humidity barometers and so on are saying that, in fact, it was clear skies, there was no cloud ceiling because there was no cloud, then that all automatically gives me huge alarm bells. So if I have, you know, a pair of witnesses insisting it was really cloud and there was a UFO just underneath the cloud and then it punched a hole in the cloud, I look at the data that's coming in, streaming in from, say, three or four different, you know, US-built, US Air Force-launched, leased satellites that are leased to our government, and I just look at it and I say, but it, you know, the whole area was dead clear. mm-hmm. and you're telling me that a UFO punched a hole in thunderstorm, you know, that's one way. So what I do, I try and find something that, you know, I say to myself, look, if they get that wrong, or if they lie, you know, that's probably a pretty strong word, but if they can't even get that right, how do I trust them when they say, you know, the spacecraft was gold on the outside and then it made a funny noise, a whistling noise, then it went up through the clouds. I just can't trust it, you know. So that's one that – pulling people up on things like that or trying to verify what they say against other known data that they might not even realize that I have access to, that's one excellent way that mm-hmm. you can sort the wheat from the chaff. Another way you can sort things out is – you know, there are some classic Hynek rules, you know, like where if you've got a single object going east to west, you know, that's for a few seconds on a clear night, they might describe it as a small spacecraft and it went for 45 seconds. First thing I do is check out like a meteor shower predictor to see if there's any heavy-duty showers like the Leonard's meteor shower or whatever, and see if there was any meteoric activity at the time. I also look for Venus. If something happens at dusk or dawn and it's hanging low slung in the sky of a greenish cream colour, people often say it's moving. The eyes can play tricks. You know, I've had cases where a person actually walked out of one front door. It was like a California bungalow with a couple of front doors. Person actually walked out one front door, saw Venus, you know, like next to a tree, and then ran inside, right, got the phone, like a cordless phone, ran outside the other front door and saw that Venus had moved to the other side of the tree. It's not that Venus had moved, it's that they'd moved. And they said to their relative on the phone, I can't believe it, it's just moved halfway across the sky and behind, you know, near the old oak tree. And I get people to recount their steps, and you see these extraordinary events where and then, of course, you go and look up where Venus actually was. And often I preempt them. I'll say, look, it didn't happen to be green or cream in colour. And they'll say, yeah, how did you know? Have you got another report? And I'll say, didn't happen to go downwards, did it? It didn't accelerate off, did it? And they'll say, no, it was just hovering like a big spaceship, big circle spaceship. And I'll say, I'm going to show you something and you're not going to like it. So, yeah, there you go.
Yeah. You know, I could go on and on about this part of the UFO field when it comes to YouTube videos and all kinds of things, but we don't really need to focus on that. I would like to ask you what you can tell us about the Victorian UFO Action group that you're involved in.
Okay, Victorian UFO Action. In Australia, we have, I think it's, hold on. We have eight states and states. So I've got to get this right. So we've got eight state and territories, and some of the states and territories have their own UFO groups. You know, there's nothing particularly national that's where there's field investigation, you know, teams in each state under one umbrella. There has been in the past, but there's not now. So each state tends to have, you know, one, two or three so-called UFO groups. Some might focus more on, you know, the personal, you know, personal or side of things. Some focus very on historical matters. Some focus on actual case investigation. What VUFOA do, what we aim to do, is to a number of things. One is archiving old records, scanning old records. One is, you know, presenting public to the public at night. But the main thing that the preamble of what VUFOA aim to do is to accept and receive incoming reports that, you know, hopefully have some detail. You know, we've got proformas, online proformas, and then proformas you can physically fill out, or we can ring witnesses, and then, you know, we investigate. So once again, you're looking immediately for inconsistencies in reports, where planets were, that sort of thing. We've had a couple of conferences. I've spoken at both of them. We've had interstate speakers. We've had actually MUFON, who I'm not a big fan of, but Chase Colette, who's a field investigator. Yeah, she came to Australia actually in September, and we
she
had
made a there was a lot of press about her there. I saw.
Yeah. She came to Australia, and we had a couple of three interstate speakers. Then Chase from Carolina, South Carolina, I think, and then me, and it was a big day. And it was like a 3-day event, including, you know, personal time and like meetings and stuff. So, but VUFO is very new. I mean, VUFO is only a few 4 years old, and there's been, in my opinion, it's been a very, very poor, to be honest, the UFO phenomena to me in Australia is nearly dead. The cases that we're getting, if you go to Australian files, like even just the Royal Australian Air Force's DAFI, Directorate of Air Force Intelligence, that is, files, or Department of Civil Aviation files, if you pick a year, any year, 65, 75, 79, 81, 83, 72, whatever, you pick a year and just alone go through what the government has chosen to keep in their files, like, you know, reports from civilians, reports from police, and even foreign nationals, even military pilots, whatever. If you go through the reports and the unit investigations, telexes, teletypes, considerations, memos, you go through all this paperwork from the 70s and 60s, you will get more cases in 2 weeks than what we are getting here, quality cases, of what we are getting here in 3 years. I mean, the phenomenon, the amount of times we are being called or sent letters or emails from, you know, hyperactive teenagers, or, you know, a truck driver who are simply seeing a meteorite go past, or a couple of meteorites in a row, or a pair of planes, you know, like people report, you know, it might be a pair of planes that go right over the top of each other at the same time. Someone will ring and say, I saw a UFO split into two, you know, and it was reflecting the sunlight. I go straight to, you know, flight 24 or web track, and I see that right at that time and place there was a, you know, a Continental Airlines flight and a Singapore Airlines flight going right across each other, you know, at 32 and 35,000 feet. You know, like we get the cases that we get range from being hoaxes and absolute trash right through to, you know, barely, you know, acceptable. We've had a couple of really good cases that have actually been videoed, like where we've had one VUFO. I had one interesting case where a girl and a friend were sitting up during a thunderstorm at a lookout, and she was actually filming on Snapchat, which I know nothing about, but she was filming a thunderstorm, and all of a sudden this white just ball of light starts screaming up and down. You know, it looks like if you look where she is, you see the dashboard of her car and the lightning strikes and the factories in the fog in the, you know, background. And I know, and she told us exactly where she was, and we got a map out, exact directions, was perfect case. She just sees this, she filmed 10 seconds of footage, well, 5 seconds of it was very clear imagery of this white hot looking sort of pulsating object just going up and down and sort of gyrating from side to side at the same time. And we took one look at a map and one look at Google Earth from the area, and what is actually in the area is massive transmission lines. So she was, if you went there during the day, she's actually looking out over a crest of a mountain. It was in a suburb called Endeavour Hills. She's looking over, she's at a lookout place in a car park, and she's looking across Melbourne's whole suburbs. Melbourne's a very big city. But right in front of her, right smack in front of her, is a massive, massive, you know, 100 metre tall metal, aluminium, steel, zinc transmission line holder upper, a pylon. It was clearly ball lightning because, you know, atmospheric plasma. It's happened right in the middle of, in fact, it was Melbourne's biggest thunderstorm in, I think it was Melbourne's biggest summer thunderstorm in 3 years, and it was right, I mean, she was filming the lightning. The air would have been, like, incredibly electrified, and we actually found a Bureau of Meteorology or an article in the paper a couple of weeks later where the Bureau of Meteorology spokesman had said that was an incredible electrical storm across Victoria. And she'd filmed what you can actually see is a piece of ball, you know, a hunk of ball lightning screaming up and down transmission lines. So, you know, that's the sort of – so we've had some very interesting cases like that where we've got some real science out of it. You know, so you can go to Project Blue Book's Condon Commission findings, and there is, you know, a subchapter there on ball lightning atmospheric plasma. It's partly – it's got contributions from Dr. Gordon Thayer and others, and you know, the fact of the matter is ball lightning is a key contributor to UFO sightings. It can go for a long time, can be very bright, it can happen out of nowhere, it can catch you right off guard, and so that's the sort of thing VFO do. I mean, so we got that case and we really studied it, and so yeah, so there you go.
Wow. Now, what would you consider the most outstanding UFO case in Australia?
Yeah, it's an interesting one, and it's a good one because it actually involves US Navy personnel. It's called the 1973 Northwest Cape incident. In Australia, we've got – Australia's a big country. Right over on the west coast, we've got a peninsula that is – it's called Northwest Cape. There's a town called Exmouth there. And just above Exmouth on the peninsula, on the absolute end of the peninsula, there is a – there is the it's now Australia's – it's now Australian government owned. But the in the 60s and 70s, there was a joint United States Navy, Royal Australian Navy facility called Northwest Cape, NAVCOM Star Naval Communications Station. And this place is probably, you know, in the top three or four most sensitive, guarded, hard to get information on, top secret security clearance bases in Australia. It'd be definitely in the top three or four. What it is, it's a communications station, like low frequency communications, scrambled and cryptographic communications, scrambling and de-scrambling, encoding and decoding, message formatting. It's a station that does key fleet command and control communications, flash communications, priority communications for the United States Navy, the Royal Australian Navy, and no one else. It's there's these stations all over the world. You know, there's a huge one in Washington specifically for Fleet Command Navy. There's a huge one in Japan. There's a huge one in Guam. Big one in Italy. Big one in Belfast. These stations use talk to satellites up and down, downlink, uplink. They talk to other communication stations, and they talk to ships. It's called shore to shore, or ship to shore communication. This station, the Naval Communications Station in Western Australia, their most important role is to submit launch orders for the United States Navy's fleet submarines for nuclear war. So if you've got submarine-launched ballistic missile-capable submarines, the United States Navy Pacific Fleet, if you've got them underneath, if you literally, your country's got them underneath the seas around Australia and World War III starts, the message will be amplified from Washington through the Earth's crust to Northwest Cape, who'll amplify it again and send it down to the submarines, which are 200 metres underwater. So this is the sort of base it is we're talking. Now, back in 1973, if you wanted to report a UFO, whether you were military, civilian, whatever, you somehow got onto the Royal Australian Air Force, preferably the nearest base, and they would send you a three-page pro forma. And that pro forma would ask you questions. It was had 20, 30 questions, ask you, you know, time and date, your age and occupation, your full name, any qualifications that might help with this case, like, you know, where you were, what time it was exactly, on and on, you know, colour of object, any sound associated, what attracted your perception, you know, how did the object disappear, how many there were, etc. Now, there's a veteran researcher, Bill Chalker, here in Australia, and he was really active in getting files out of the Australian government, whether that's through literally being in the Australian government's you know, buildings and actually studying their files, or getting files released under through government people, for UFO researchers to study, you know, under scrutiny and so on. And in 1977, I think Bill was handed some Australian Royal Australian Air Force pro formas that had been filled out by civilians and people in Australia, and he was in a group of UFO researchers, and I think it was the public relations guy for the Royal Australian Air Force who gave them this pile of files to study for a few hours, and Bill came across this absolutely unbelievable case that came out of Northwest Cape, the place I was talking about. What it said was this: there was 10 pages, and those pages were filled in by two men. One was a lieutenant commander for the United States Navy who had expertise. Lieutenant commanders rank quite highly. That's the equivalent, I think, of either major or lieutenant colonel, maybe even colonel in the Army or Air Force. But so it was lieutenant commander, we think William, because you can't see the writing on that bit, but it was someone Moyer. So we think lieutenant commander William Moyer. And his expertise were in radar tracking, gunnery, etc. And the other guy that filled out pro formas was an Australian firefighting expert. And the story went like this. Both of them were on the base. It was 7:15 thereabouts at night. And the sun had just gone down. The skies were, you know, totally clear. You read these pro formas and it's shocking. What they both saw, they didn't even know each other, but they were on two different parts of the base. One of the guys was actually closing up buildings and he looked up and he saw a black sort of oval object in the sky, right at, or, you know, nearly above the base. For all intents and purposes, it had intruded on the bases. We're pretty sure of that. This black object with pulsating lights or pulsating apparitions going round it. And they described it as being quite big. You know, they felt that it was, they felt, you know, this, what, well, the first pro forma said it could have been, you know, 300 feet wide. So he's standing there trying to close up buildings and he saw this thing for 20 seconds. He watched it. Okay. That's what he wrote down. He even had a watch with him. He watched it for 20 seconds. And most of the pro forma that he filled in goes on and on and on about one particular thing. And that particular thing is the speed that it took off. He writes where the pro forma says, you know, how did the object leave? And he writes, it left at unbelievable speed. It just accelerated. Never seen anything like it. That's what he wrote in handwriting. We've got it, you know. In another part of the pro forma, it says, what was particularly unusual about your sighting? And again, he writes, took off at unbelievable speed, extraordinary acceleration. Now, so that was one of the witnesses. The other witness, who was around about 8 kilometres, which in your language is about 5 miles away, he was driving and he pulled over and he actually saw it for a lot longer. He witnessed it for, I think it was 4 minutes. He said exactly the same thing. A black object with lights going around it, you know, appreciably large, never seen anything like it. And he wrote, you know, never seen anything like it, accelerated at extraordinary speed. He even wrote the total unbelievability of it all. They even drew pictures. They even made written statements. I mean, not only did they fill out the Royal Australian Air Force pro forma questionnaires, they made full written statements on foolscap paper. Now, Bill Chalker got these papers out. He couldn't believe he was allowed to see them, but he did, and he kept them. And we've come back, but Pete, me and researcher Keith Basterfield have come back and studied this case again over the years. And it's just stunning because we've actually tracked down the family. One of the witnesses, Bill Lynn, the fire captain, we tracked down his family and we wanted, you know, to do as, and they said, or the family came to us and they were prepared to talk to us. And they came to us with samples of his handwriting so we could check the pro formas. They came with pictures of him being a fire captain in Western Australia, just so we could, you know, verify the provenance of this guy. And so they always said that he stood by, like he absolutely said this did happen. His kids grew up knowing Dad as, you know, Dad with the story about the UFO back at Northwest Cape. And their dad had always told them that he never really knew if it was an actual UFO from somewhere else or what he called a spy craft, We don't know. We've looked into everything from Soviet launched submarine cruise missiles, which were just being used in the Baltic Sea at the time for test and evaluation purposes. We looked into, you know, like the area's restricted airspace. You can't paint the planes black in Australia. So we even looked into, you know, possibility of a formation of, you know, 150,000 birds going around in circles. None of it fits. I mean, so that to me is, you know, that to me is probably could be Australia's most powerful case, simply for the fact is you've got two different witnesses in two totally different places with reasonable credentials behind them on a very sensitive military base. You've got existing paperwork, 10 pages of it now. You've got family. I've tried to get onto the United States Navy's Lieutenant Commander Moyer's family or through the Naval Heritage and Historical Society, plus US Naval personnel, which I think was in Norfolk or San Diego or something. I've tried to track down all, you know, Moyers, Lieutenant Commander Moyers, who were in overseas in, you know, NAVCOM star stations in the 70s. And there's quite a few, but they don't fit. They're either too old or they're too young. And so that's been very, very difficult. I would like to hear from the only living person would be Lieutenant Commander Moyer, and he may not even be alive. So that's a shame. But the case is quite provocative.
Now, wasn't there a case – now, I may be getting this confused, and if so, we'll just move on. But was there a case where I believe it was a woman driving along and some other people driving along on maybe a highway or something like that, and they see a UFO land and they actually see beings? Am I thinking of Australia or
– Yep.
I am.
Well, that could be – well, there's a lot of cases like that. I mean, that's probably no different. There is probably no difference. That's probably no different than a lot of cases around the world. But I think what you might be talking about is the Kelly Carhill case.
That sounds right to me.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. The problem is with that is that the testimony, the evidence – is extremely contradictory. It's one of the I've never looked at it really closely, you know, for months on end, but it is very, very what you would call messy and very murky. So, you know, claims were made, for example, that aside from she was driving along and apparently had missing time and claimed she was abducted by something. When some UFO researchers got into the case, they claimed that there were other witnesses behind her in cars, two cars behind her that also confirmed the whole thing. Those are just claims. The UFO researcher that made those claims, he never produced a single shred of evidence for it. He claimed, for instance, that other witnesses went on radio saying, yes, the event happened. We saw a woman encounter a UFO in front of us on the road at night. The radio station knew nothing about it. It was claimed that two of the witnesses did a magazine-like interview in a German magazine. Well, we are yet to see, after, 20 years, we're yet to see that article come out. The German magazine know nothing about it. There was one researcher claimed he went door knocking in the area and then sometime later other researchers also went door knocking. And each person in the house said, you're the first person to come door knocking. There has been no other researcher here before wanting to talk to locals in the community. Kelly Carhill, it's an extremely unreliable case. Look, there may have been something to it. I'm not sure. But anything that messy, I won't touch because it's just not worth my time. You know, I can do so much better research without groveling in that sort of thing.
Now, most of the population in Australia is coastline. And so you have this vast open area. I mean, maybe I'm getting this wrong, but I believe that you have like a vast open area that's very sparsely populated. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And are there are all the sightings along the coastline, or are there some reports in that area?
No way. It's absolutely could be anywhere. You get reports from out at sea, from fishing, you know, communities. You get reports along beaches. You get reports well into the desert. Like I was saying before, the Aboriginals have been seeing weird stuff hovering around the ground for, you know, millennia. You can, in fact, rural areas of Australia, well inland, you know, you are right. 95% of Australia's population live within 60 kilometres, or you'd say 40 miles from the coastline. It's a bit like Canada. Canada's population all hug the US border. In cities, and our population all hug the coastline in cities. But look, there are towns inland, particularly in New South Wales and Victoria and Queensland. There are myriad towns inland, huge farming communities, mining communities, service towns. Some of the best reports, has, like I was saying before, though, we are in an incredibly dry spell. I would almost be able to. I was joking about this with someone the other day. I could almost put together an article saying that the UFO phenomenon has ceased to exist in this country. And I think that I'd be, you know, almost. It wouldn't be that hard to pull off. But anyway, historically, and. Now, reports can absolutely be from anywhere. Historically, a lot of excellent reports, a lot of our classic cases have come in from country towns, bushland, the outback. Well, I've got a case that actually happened above, right in the middle of central Australia, so what we call, you know, the true outback, the heartland of the country, near Ayers Rock, your listeners would know. We've got this in Australia. There's two organisations that monitor, or you know, that deal with air safety, or that deal with air safety pilot reports, near misses. One organisation is called Air Services Australia. The other organisation is called the Australian Transport Safety Bureau. And a couple of years ago, through research, I found out that. Say the Air Services Australia, they keep any pilot reports of near misses, unknown aircraft, UFOs technically, but you know, any unknown aircraft, near misses, planes getting too close to each other, unknown planes or unusual planes on the runway that shouldn't be there, planes flying, you know, like well into controlled airspace and not, you know, talking back, those cases, those reports and that paperwork, those electronic messages and forms are kept on something called the ESIR database, which is Electronically Submitted Incident Report. And I asked Air Services Australia, under the Freedom of Information Act, I asked them a year ago, I said, I want any copies of, in your ESIR database, I want any copies of reports that have the terms or the keywords in those reports from pilots that have the, you know, keywords unusual, unknown, unidentified, out of place, near miss, air prox, UFO, flying disc, cigar, triangle. I put in all those classic keywords. So I specified a date range because I didn't want them to knock me back for the FOI being too broad. So I specified a date range of between 1998 and 2007 or whatever. So they went and searched through all their database records, like archives. They're in a type of spreadsheet, very complex type of spreadsheet, and they found a number of very unusual cases. But one of them was a case where. In 1999, quite late at night, like 10 o'clock at night, two planes had taken off, like in Australia, in the Northern Territory, right up the top of Australia, two planes had taken off roughly at the same time. Both of them were Israeli Westwind jets, which go really fast. They go, you know, they can just break the sound barrier if they really want to. These two jets, one took off from Darwin, which is a city in the very north, and one took off from Tyndall, which is another city in the north. Or Catherine, it took off from Tyndall Airport. And both were flying dead south towards Alice Springs, which is right in the middle of the country. And it says in the paperwork, it says pilots of AJP Darwin and AJK Tyndall, so that's the two planes, report seeing green light trailing one of the two aircraft. Then in the description it says pilots of Tyndall, pilots from AJC Tyndall and AJP Darwin have reported a green light first tracking one of the two planes, then going up and down in the atmosphere. both planes witnessed it. So what we've got a situation is where one pilot, the plane at the front of the two that are flying south, the guy that's at the front, it's a two-crew plane. It's actually, we found out that the actual flights were carrying money and checks and deposit slips and so on. They take cash and money around this particular company, Pal Air, I think it was called, chartered by our banks to take money around the country, like cash and coins. And these two planes were both carrying, you know, like consignments of money and cash and deposit slips, term deposits and so on. And they're flying south. And one of the pilots, effectively, if you read this document, it says that there's an official government document for Australia's air services. And it's saying that one pilot is actually being trailed or chased or whatever by a green light that's first dipping up and down in the atmosphere, then it's actually following him for an extended period of time. Then the plane that's behind him by, you know, like, say, we don't know, but we'll say 8 miles or whatever, he's seeing this whole thing as well happen. Now, this is all going on. A west wind jet can fly as high as 41,000 feet. On cruise mode, they've probably fly at something like 32,000 feet. It's pretty high up. It totally rules out helicopters. It even says in the paperwork, it says Brisbane sector has no other aircraft in the TOPS area, which means that nowhere else in Central Australia that near these aircraft is there other aircraft. Like, if you believe what the paperwork says, it's saying that there are no known or there are no civilian aircraft up there, and there are also no known military aircraft up there. Now, were the Royal Australian Air Force, probably from something like 13th Squadron or whatever it was, or one of the AWACS aircraft with the green light on the wing, were they buzzing these aircraft or were they playing funny games? I'm not sure. But the area is used – I mean, Australia's vast so that we can do what we want here. The area is used sometimes. I know from a contact in the military, and it's not classified or anything, but I do know that the area is used for – we've got FA-18 Hornets and Super Hornets from General Dynamics from your country. We do fly Hornets on training and manoeuvre missions, zoom climbs, zoom dives in that area, but we do it in every other area. So was it an FA-18 Hornet flying at an FAA Hornet low speed, dipping up and down and then trailing an aircraft? I wouldn't have thought that would be very, you know, safe. I wouldn't have thought there'd be any need to be doing it around two fast-moving, corporate jets. Mm. But there is that possibility. There is also the possibility is that it was a bona fide UFO. Now, the event wasn't one of these 10-second events. It clearly went for a long time because they had enough time to see that it was dipping up and down and then following the front aircraft. It's bright green, so they must have been able to, make that decision that it was green, that it was a light, that it wasn't a reflection. You know, with all this is going on 35,000 feet, I don't see possibly how it can be a scientific or weather balloon or military balloon or radar sonde balloon. I don't think balloons, even highly reflective balloons, can reflect enough light that they could actually be seen, you know, miles away from a cockpit at night, bear in mind. Helicopters ruled out. Missiles, our consignment, things like Harpoon missiles we have here, they do not have lights on them. There's absolutely no reason to. They're offensive missiles for blowing up bunkers. They would not have a green light show. We've verified all this through Air Power Australia's magazines that release information about short-range and medium-range cruise missiles that we use here. We can't figure out what the light was. So it happened right in the middle of Australia. So to answer your question, yes, it can happen anywhere.
Now, on the message board, there was a question, what about the SDS video that shows what looks like a laser shooting at something in space, I guess from Australia? Are you familiar with that?
Yeah, I am. I absolutely am. What that is I know exactly what he's talking about. I think it was about 1993. There is quite a well-known video of an object that you can see the curvature. It was taken from the space shuttle Columbia, I think. You can see the curvature of the Earth's surface. You can see the glow of the atmosphere. It's actually black and white, maybe with a bit of green imagery. It's quite blurry. I mean, it's not like the high definition, you know, panoramic imagery we have today that's in all sorts of, that can be in near infrared and optical, but it's black and whitish footage from, it's showing the curvature of the Earth over Western Australia. So the space shuttle would have been over Western Australia or the Indian Ocean. So it's looking down sort of diagonally on the centre of Australia. What you see, there's this small dot out in space next to the Earth. There's this very small dot. It could be very far away. And it's moving leisurely along. And all of a sudden, there's a flash. There appears to be a flash sort of away from the camera. Somewhere there's this flash. And at exactly the same time, two things happen. The object that's moving sort of lazily across space suddenly stops for a minuscule period of time and just suddenly takes off in a total opposite direction. And at exactly the same time as that happens, you see this flash, it's this streak of light coming up from Australia, or, you know, coming up from what would appear to be Australia, whether it's a very shiny meteorite that just happens to be passing on an unfortunate trajectory, or whether it is actually coming up from Earth, I don't know. The footage is very short. It's always been – I don't know much about the footage itself and the technical specs behind it, but the footage – how can I explain this? That we've always been told in documentaries that the footage shows – that something comes up from the centre of Australia and rips right, you know, goes right past this UFO that was, I admit, looks like it does a 90-degree turn. The problem is, I've never verified it. I mean, I've never seen a single piece I've never been shown sort of any space shuttle orbital logs for the period of time, Windows Media Player usable map outs for where the space shuttle was going over Earth, any details on the camera, you know, just because it frustrates me, because even things that get into quite acceptably sensible documentaries sometimes are just plain wrong. You know, like just because a documentary told me that a streak of light was probably some sort of weapon coming up from Australia, that, you know, the footage was taken over Australia. Well, I'll tell you what, how do we know that that wasn't chucked together at the last minute in the editing room of the documentary? They're there to make money. They're not there. They don't need to be scientifically accurate. They don't need to do that. What your friend, I can't pronounce his name,
Alejandro,
that's him. What he was saying before about, it just is so true. What he was saying before about the media, there is no accountability. That, you know, they don't have to get things right. And as long as they're not saying stuff that is so outrageous that it totally defames someone or, you know, causes someone huge amounts of grief, they actually don't have to get anything right. The newspapers, particularly, you know, magazines, particularly internet forums, press releases from small media organisations, there's nothing stopping them getting things wrong. I mean, you just have to look at the spelling in some of these newspaper articles to see that you're dealing with people who are writing for an audience that will often accept anything. That, I mean, what Rojas was saying before about, you know, these journalists have no scientific background, they have no technical background, they have no operational military or defence or aviation background. In a space of one day, you can see one journalist writing about, you know, new colour themes for second story houses in, you know, I don't know, the Delaware area for next year. And then next thing they're doing a story on, you know, UFO. UFO file releases, and then the week after that they're covering a hit and run car accident. I mean, drink driving. It's just there's no accountability because there doesn't need to be. So just because, look, to answer the person who sent that question in, I don't know if it happened over Australia. I don't know what it shows. It is quite interesting footage, I will admit that. People have made a lot of it over the years. I wish we could get a better copy. I know that NASA, people say, well, NASA just hide everything, NASA record everything. Well, it's not like that. NASA have been going for a long time and they throw out enormous amounts of stuff. If it's not operationally important, if it's not important for statistical analysis later, safety analysis later, astronaut safety, you know, there's quite a possibility that that particular segment of footage or a whole year's worth of footage from that particular camera, let's not forget the shuttle has dozens of cameras on it, if that footage is not useful to them, or if that footage is, say, duplicated by some other footage that is done from a similar part of the shuttle, they're just not going to keep it. And, I mean, I have thought before about actually FOIing, Freedom of Information requesting a segment of that footage from that period of time, maybe an extra 10 minutes worth either side of the weird movement of this unknown and this thing that streaks through space. I've thought about FOIing it because that's what I do best, FOI requests. But I wouldn't be surprised if, one, they can't find it, two, they actually have legitimately thrown it out, or three, they simply knock it back by saying, look, you know, we're not up to archiving that. You know, we're in a grey area at the moment. That stuff hasn't been archived for public dissemination, but it's also not still readily available where we can grab it for you right now. You know, I just don't know what sort of answer I'd get, but I'm not hopeful. But if someone else wants to or correspond with me about, you know, trying to get it out, it could take 2 years, but we'll see if we can get a better copy of the footage maybe. I don't know.
One of the things I wanted to ask you along these lines is how would you rate the U.S. as far as is the U.S. and Australia very similar when it comes to documents and FOA, FOIA requests and things like that?
Okay, the United States. One thing you'll get from Australia's what Australia has released officially under the Archives Act, or from official leaks like press, you know, official leaks or press releases plus FOI requests like what I do. What we've released is it just screams small country, tight military, you know. Very, you know, like we have just simply not got the same level of interest, the paperwork, the classified paperwork, the I mean, alone Australia alone only has something like, you know, 10 operational Air Force bases. The United States might have, including Air National Guard, in the United States. The United States might have, I don't know, 150. I mean, and that's not including the ones, the US Air Force bases in Europe and you know, Guam, South Korea. So we just have the amount of paperwork that you guys have produced from 1946, 47 onwards till presumably now is vastly, vastly larger, you know, orders and orders of magnitude larger than what we have done. One thing that is different is that our FOI laws are very, very respectable and respected here. Like, we have a very, very good Freedom of Information Act adherence within the government. You can submit a Freedom of Information request and it is acknowledged within, you know, 48 hours.
Really?
It is. Yeah, absolutely. It is taken on seriously. If they feel that it's not right, like if you do an FOI request, I don't know, I might say an FOI request for any gun camera footage or infrared forward-looking footage from a combat jet of the, I don't know, 30th Squadron that shows unidentified aircraft between the years of, I don't know, 2000-2010, they will actually, if that request isn't right, they will actually come back and help you. Like, they will actually come back and say, well, Mr. Dean, the problem is 30th Squadron didn't exist at the start of your time period. You might want to change that to 25th Squadron, and then you'll get some hits. Like, they'll actually come back and help you.
Wow.
You know, aside, then they've got really specific laws. Like, for instance, if they've got to give you answers within 30 days. Like, they've got to say, right, we've found documents, or we've searched documents, or searched for documents and found them. Or they've got to say, no, we have searched for documents, can't find a thing, or they say we need a time extension. Could be over Christmas, or, you know, where manpower is considerably down or whatever. And even when they ask for an extension, there is a provision in there for you to say no. Like, you can say no, I insist that you do it. Yeah, there is. They actually write these kind letters saying, like, you know, we hope that you would respect, you know, for both our sanities, we hope that you would respect the need for an extra 30 days on this request. Now, so they actually help you right through it. Now, they, our Department of Defense, our civil aviation body, so Department of Defense is Army, Air Force, Navy, and other administrative areas. Civil aviation, Coast Guard, and so on. They are so responsive they take the FOI Act very seriously. If you're not happy, you can appeal, and you can appeal to multiple different authorities. So in that respect, it's a lot. I've dealt with the US FO. I've dealt directly with the United States military through their FOI offices. So I've dealt with NORTHCOM, which is a Unified Combatant Command, and NORAD, which is underneath or subordinate to NORTHCOM. I've dealt with the 1st Air National Guard. I've dealt directly with 14th Air Force. I've dealt directly with Air Force Space Command out of Peterson, Air Force Base. I've developed, even right down to squadron level, I've dealt with the 6th Space Missile Warning Squadron at some Cape Cod Air Station. And your FOI system is in an absolute shambles. The United States Air Force, if you do an FOI request to the United States Air Force Secretary or Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for materials, might be policy materials, procedural materials, high-level doctrine, I'm quite serious. They are supposed to, I believe, supposed to respond within 30 days, and then they can easily ask for another 30 days, and then they always go over anyway. But your US Air Force, particularly at high level, so Secretary of the Air Force level, their wait time at the moment can be up to 2 years.
Right, I've heard that.
To even come back. Yeah, it's shocking.
Pardon me. What about the redaction of documents in Australia?
Yeah, the thing is, there's got to be something to redact. So the thing is, when Australia's civil aviation bodies, the amount of planes we have in the sky, military is so much smaller. So there is going to be, just by virtue, so much less UFO stuff in paperwork. Mm-hmm. There's going to be less unidentified aircraft annoying planes. There's going to be less UFOs reported by civilians. Not that civilians can't actually report UFOs to the government anymore. You have to either go to the police or a UFO group.
But, really? Wow.
Yeah, it's a bit pathetic. Oh, you can go to your local airport and they'll write everything down. But it depends on the UFO. If it looks like it's something like a burning aircraft, or say re-entered space debris, which might be, of course, technically very important. It could be a Soviet rocket boost or whatever. That they'll take seriously. But if it's a pair of flying saucers and you say there was windows on board, they will say, look, we got out of this 20 years ago. Go to a UFO group or go to a psychiatrist. With redaction of documents, the US definitely redacts more heavily. I've seen Australian documents that have come out, and I've looked at them, I've gone, wow, this would never come out in the United States because you guys are running you're running in an age of cybercrime, espionage, terrorism. You're trying to sell armaments to the rest of the world. There is nothing worse than, let's say there was a case where IFOI'd an F-22 Raptor, which is a new aircraft, reasonably new, say the vertical scan, track while scan radar picked up an unknown bogey, and I did an FOI request on that. Let's say they gave me a whole bunch of track while scan images, actual pictorial images of a bogey on a screen, plus, printouts of radar for track file creation, fade time, rise time, movement of the object, name of the pilot, etc. Let's say I got that under FOI. Then let's say to understand that, let's say I did another FOI for the manual, the actual user's manual for that radar system. There is no way your government will release it. And fair enough, because you probably paid $1 billion for it. You know, why would the US – I see this a lot. People say, oh, everything's redacted. They're trying to hide something. And I look at it and I say, no. If you look at this, they're actually trying to hide collection methods. They're trying to hide things like radar frequencies. Like, there is no way that Elmendorf-Richardson Air Force Base, say in Alaska, that's frontline air defense for Soviet bombers – or Soviet medium or long-range cruise missiles, there is no way they should be handing over their frequency skipping algorithms, height-finding radar algorithms, their base alert procedures, five-minute warnings, 10-minute scramble alerts, rules of engagement doctrine. Why should they hand that over simply because I think that there might have been a UFO up there one day a few years ago? So that's why usually, not always, I'm not saying always, but usually that's why those redactions are in place. They are actually dead legitimate. I've seen I have studied UFO documents all my life, and I've seen cases where, say, in 1983, a document will come out, a two-page, 10-page file, whatever it is, and it's just full of black ink. And then in 2010, the same document finally gets released, and you look at it, and sure enough, there's nothing in there much about UFOs, but there's a whole lot about intelligence collection methods, phone numbers of classified cells within, you know, within army aviation or within, you know, air combat command or whatever. There might be material in there, secret, you know, classified code names. There might be, you know, rank and file and whole, you know, stuff about pilots. And there might be material in there about storage of documents that, you know, that it might. So I think a lot of these redactions are absolutely legitimate, but some I think are way too old and quite ridiculous. You've got some. There's a 1961 memo called the Air Force Chief of Intelligence Collections Memoranda. It's usually called the Betts memo, the Colonel Betts memo. It's from 1961, and there's whole sections that are completely redacted. And I think that's ridiculous. I mean, we're dealing with something. I mean, this document was created before John F. Kennedy was killed. You know, most people who see this now weren't even alive in 1961. So to me, redactions like that, they cause more embarrassment than what they would, what it does if they just released the things. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. We have about 6 minutes. I can run over. I was just typing to the chat room that the Dark Matter Digital Network needs me to, you know, close the show out at 2 hours. But I can definitely, if it goes longer than that, I can edit. Anyway, I'd like to ask you about what the has there been reports since most of the population is along the coastline? You said 95%.
Sure.
What about USOs? Are there reports of underwater?
Now that I don't know. I've been through the our National Archives holds records of the Royal Australian Navy, and we've had submarines since, you know, year dot. We've always had a proud navy, fairly large, you'd expect so with a coastal country. I don't think I've ever seen an official government like a Royal Australian Navy or Coast Watch or, you know, merchant shipping document that discusses underwater, you know, submerged objects, strange objects that shouldn't be there, out of place torpedoes, UFOs for underneath the sea. I've never seen anything. There has been reports. Look, there has been something strange back a long, long time ago. I think in 1902 or 1909 thereabouts, in the Indian Ocean, which is really vast. There was numerous people around, like Sri Lanka and Australia and Christmas Island and so on, that were reporting underwater wheels, like these golden, these spinning, massive spinning golden underwater wheels. Hmm. And I've got no idea what to make of it. I don't know much about it. They're in ship logs. They appeared in newspaper articles, like, you know, fishing vessels or prawn trawlers would pull in to, you know, a fishing community and, you know, they'd discuss with their families, the local people, about, you know, these extraordinary shiny wheels they'd see, massive. I'm talking dwarf the size of a ship, right underneath the ship or right next to the ship, and then these things would just vanish and not come back again. And they'd discuss this. It would be in a local paper, in a small newspaper article at times. It wouldn't be surprising if it's the sort of thing Jacques Vallée would study. Magonia studies, you know, pre-1940s UFO lore is really interesting. And it's sort of – you wonder if it is it core UFO phenomena, or is it bordering on phenomenology, like just high strangeness stuff, you know, the paranormal? I mean, where do you draw the line? I mean, what is a UFO or a USO? I mean, is it something – if a tight metallic – aeroform that dips into the ocean, is that a USO, or is a, you know, a vague blue light you see underwater, is that a USO, or does it have to be somewhere in between for the demarcation between, you know, UFO or USO, you know, between that and, you know, just underwater or aerial phenomena of some sort, you know, a paranormal, ghostly, spirit like a hallucination, whatever, you know, where is the line? And that's something that I've always been very, very clear with. You know, if it appears to be not in any way atmospherically interesting, not freak weather conditions, then I move on to something that I can do. You know, there's nothing better than dealing with core information, you know, released documents with cover letters, you know, question and answer forms with pilots or air traffic controllers. That's what keeps me going in the field.
Wow. Now, let's talk quickly. We got a couple of minutes left. Let's talk quickly about your blog. I read through some of that, and a lot of that had, or there was one article about documents. So about your blog, can somebody actually reach you from your blog?
Yeah. My email, the blog, if anyone goes to the internet, Google, I suppose, and types in UFOs documenting the evidence. So, yeah, UFOsDocumentingTheEvidence.com.au, I think that's what you need to do. You'll see it's a dark-coloured blog with white writing. My email address is at the top, but just for any listeners that do want to email, my email address, all lowercase, is pj_deaN@hotmail.com. But my email address is there on the blog, and you can leave comments. My blog mostly deals with I do primary research, stuff that's never been done before, you know, like results of FOI requests with the Australian government, results of FOI requests with the Americans, archival searches in the CIA CREST system, archival searches in old FOI disclosure logs, the study of documents, you know, what certain code words mean now, what certain chains of command mean. I study where UFOs have popped up in the strangest of places, pilot encounters, stuff that I try and focus on material that's not just rehashed. I mean, so many blogs you go to are simply rehashed stuff about, you know, UFO videos and cases that have been done to death. There are so many blogs right now, for example, about, you know, in the last few years have been about the Bentwaters Air Force Base, Rendlesham Forest fiasco. And, I mean, I think that was a real case. Actually, the Holt memo, the famous Holt memo, I've got it. Well, I haven't got the original, but the guy who actually got that out was an American researcher called Robert Todd. He was the most prolific FOI researcher in history. He was submitting up to, and if you can believe this, 20 FOI requests a day. Wow. To the US government in the 70s. And sometimes it might only be 10 a week, which is still a massive amount. But he was actually one who got the – from England, he was the one that through Her Majesty's government, through the Secretary of the Air Force, got the Holt memo out. Well, you've never seen anything until you see his original letter to them and their reply with the attachment of the actual Holt memo from the Rendlesham Forest business. That case – you know, there's been four major books on it. It's appeared in countless magazines and other books. It must have 60 or 100 documentaries or sections of documentaries on it. There is only so far you can go. There are so many blogs that just push this and push this and push this, and I wanted to do something totally different that nobody had ever done before, you know, where it actually costs money and where it actually costs an enormous amount of my time and a lot of photocopying and scanning and typing out writing, not just copying and pasting. I have seen blogs by people where entire blogs have been copied from someone else's blog and then it'll say, by James Smith. So they're actually thieving it now. Like, this is shocking.
You know, the other side of that is, if they're looking for hits, Google, for one, will penalize someone for doing that. And that'll actually knock the website back. Well, so that's one good thing when they're doing that.
Oh, one thing I was going to say was your friend Alejandro Rojas, he mentioned that Lee Spiegel was, you know, quite prominent in pushing, as a journalist, in pushing fairness and in, you know, with media. There's one other guy that I absolutely love, and you should, his name is Billy Cox in Florida, and he's with like the Miami Tribune or something, but he has a blog called Devoid, two words, DE VOID, but he is specifically a journalist and he taps into the UFO subject every week, every month. He's been doing it for 20 years, and you might remember that story that Reagan lent over to in Close Encounters to Spielberg and said, you wouldn't believe how close this is to the truth. Well, Billy Cox was the guy that actually broke that story. He's done this a few times and he's never been given credit for it. His journalistic excellence with the UFO matter is A1. And
wow.
So yeah, but I mean, there's so few of them. There's so few journalists with even a slight degree of technical background who are willing to write extensive articles and actually, you know, not go for the quick fix, the advertisements that plague the side of stories, the you know, the sound bites, the addition of, you know, 10 YouTube videos that are so questionable. Yeah, it is a big problem.
Yes, it is. Well, thank you so much. It was absolutely wonderful. And I'd like to say something that I don't say a whole lot is I'd like to invite you back. You were really great.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yes. Sure.
Wonderful. So thanks so much.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
All right, everyone. So thank you very much for listening. And just a couple of quick announcements. And thank you for supporting the show or listening live, either one. I appreciate both. Next week, we have Paul Kimball on, another Paul. Should be an interesting show. And let's see. I want to thank a few people. And I want to thank Peggy for managing the Facebook page. Of course, our guest, Paul Kimball. And also, I want to thank Keith for running our show still over at the Dark Matter Digital Network. That's on Thursday nights from 9 to 11. And I think that's about it. So, everyone, thanks so much, and we'll be seeing you at the same time right here on podcastufo.com on 8 p.m. next week, Eastern Standard Time. All right, everyone, remember to keep your eyes to the sky, and we'll see you next week.